let's take a look at s underscore bts and bdch underscore job. Okay, now to create a background job, okay, you don't need any specific special authorizations. For example, in the example that we saw for RSUSR 002, we just executed a C38 and executed the program in the background, and a job was created, right? So you don't need any specific authorizations for BTCH underscore job to do that. Okay, so without any specific authorizations, a job will be created, but the job will not be released, which means that the job will not run. Okay, but because we have SAP all it ran, otherwise it won't have run. But to create it, you don't need any special authorizations. Now, in a system, this is a important, I mean, in a system, if you want to find out a list of people who can release or execute jobs, then you have to look for this object, because this object controls the activities that you can perform on a background job, whether you can create it, delete it, release it, schedule it, copy it. Anything to do with a background job is controlled by this object s underscore btch underscore job. Okay, so that's why this is in the, for the background jobs, this is the most important object. Now, by default, when a background job is created, it is scheduled to run under the user ID of the person who scheduled the job. So if you're executing, creating a background job, your ID is the one who runs it also. Okay? But that could be a problem. So in situations where you go to some transaction code and some program and execute in background, you can't help it. Okay? But when you're creating a specific background job, a job specifically using SM36, then you have to take care of who can run the job, which ID can be used to run the job. Okay? Normally, you do not want a user for a job step to be the same user as the person who created the job. Right? So if you're creating the job, normally it should not be your own ID that should run the job. Okay? SAP recommends that you define specific users for background processing. So every customer, when you go on a project, you'll find that every customer at every place, you'll have some specific batch IDs. Okay? Which are used for background jobs. And there is a reason for that. Okay? And we'll see what those reasons are. Now, define this specific IDs that we are talking about. The batch IDs as the system users. So when you create a user ID, you have 5 user types, right? Dialogue, system, communication, reference, right? So when you create these specific user IDs for background jobs, you create them as system type user IDs, not dialogue type. Because you don't want people to use the password for this user ID to log into the system. You understand? So because if anybody who logs the, when see if it's a back seat, it doesn't mean, you know, you cannot use a dialogue user ID. You can. But the problem with the dialogue user ID is somebody can use that user ID to log into the system. And typically when you log in, after 3 attempts, if the user is entering wrong password, the ID gets locked. When the ID gets locked, whatever background jobs are using that ID, they start failing. Because the system is not going to get that authorizations for that user ID. Okay, so there are reasons why it has to be a specific user ID, batch ID, of system type. Now, this user should have only the required authorizations for the jobs that they need to run. This is a little difficult scenario. for if you're creating a background job, right? System type user ID, what SAP recommends is that you give specific authorizations to those IDs so that, you know, whatever jobs they are supposed to run, they have adequate authorizations for it. So which means you have to understand what are the kind of jobs this specific user ID is going to run and then build a role accordingly to give proper authorizations. You understood? Many places what they do is they give SAP auth. See, because it's a system, right? System type user ID, users cannot use it to log in, right? Using a password. So people sometimes feel that SAP all is good enough for this type of user IDs. But there are some people, some customers who are very particular about only giving acts, only specific authorizations, not SAP all. Okay, but SAP also recommends that you give only specific authorizations, not SAP. Now, there are some reasons to use specific user IDs for background jobs. User ID is stable. The user never changes the jobs or departments. It's a generic user ID, right? So it's not associated with any specific person. The ID is stable. When using a system user ID, the password does not have to be reset, obviously, right? User ID is used only for background processing. No one can log on with this user ID. So that means password will not be reset, which means another thing is, even if you enter wrong passwords n number of times, the ID will not be locked. Okay? The user ID facilitates security administration and maintenance of background schedule. Okay? So to run the background jobs, you have to use a specific generic batch IDs, which are of system type or communication type. So why do you have to use specific generic user IDs to run the jobs? And we'll see where they are specified, okay? Where you have to specify that ID. Using specific system users for background jobs is recommended for several reasons. Generic user ID, not your own ID, not an individual's ID, a generic ID. Why? Let us assume that Smith Joe is a person. Joe Smith is the user. His ID is Smith Joe. Has scheduled a background job for checks, for check printing that runs nightly. Okay, let's say your ID is used for running this job. Now, if Smith Joe transfers from the accounts payable department to the collections department, okay, Smith Joe should no longer have access to print checks, right? Which means once he changes the department, his authorizations are going to change, right? So, which means that once the Smith Joe's authorization changes, which means the background jobs would fail with Smith Joe's new authorizations, because the background job was scheduled to run the payroll, right? The check printing. So earlier Smith Joe had that access. Now, because he changed the department, he doesn't have access to check printing. So which means the background job that got scheduled is going to look for check printing access, which Smith Joe does not have anymore. So the background job is going to fail. That is one scenario where the Smith Joe has changed the department. What if Smith Joe has left the company itself? So when the user leaves the company, what do? You lock the user ID or you delete the user ID. So which means, even if when you log the user ID or when you delete the user ID, the background job is not going to find that user ID to run it. So every background jobs needs an ID to run, okay? So when you delete the ID, the system is not going to find it. So what happens? The background jobs are going to fail. Right? So that is the problem if you use specific normal user IDs, you know, people's user ID. Let's say if you use a generic user ID, then it's not associated with anyone, right? There is no point in, and it will never be locked. So even if you leave the company, that you created the job, but you created the job so that a generic user ID can run it, you left the company, the generic ID is still there. Your ID gets deleted, but the generic ID is still there. So the job still keeps running. Follow? So to run the jobs, you use a generic user ID. So batch bsn_ch_job controls your background jobs, everything within the background jobs. Okay. Now let's see, how do you create a background job using the transaction code SM36, and we'll see where the generic ID is specified. So let's go and create a background job, say SM36, using the transaction SM36. Now to do this, I need access to s_btch_job. Okay, let's say z test or whatever name you want to create, job. Then create the step option. Okay, now you see this user ID here. This is the user ID that will run the job. See, I logged in with my ID, but I'm creating the job, and here I specify, let's say, okay, now this ID has to be a generic user ID, an ID that will never be deleted, that will never be used by anyone, that will never be locked. It has to be that kind of an ID. Okay, so let's go and do this. Okay. Then you say save. Okay. Then you go to start condition, immediate, date and time. Specify a specific date and time. Okay. Or you want to say immediate. Want to be a specific period of job, immediate, when you click on immediate, this automatically comes up, immediate start. Then periodic job, if you want to run it every once in a while, what would be the period? Hourly. Or daily. Or weekly. Or monthly. Or other period, every 2 months, 10 months, 10 weeks, whatever. So you can specify the period in which you want to run this. So once you specify that, save it, and now you save this. Okay, now the job status has saved with status released. Now to check this, you have to go to transaction SM37 to check the status of the job. Mm-hmm. So go to ztest. What was that? Ztest job. Right? And you can give the date range also. is the one, say job. Okay. And when I take a look at the log, it will tell you what happened, who executed it. It's not created by, you executed, okay? So you have the generic ID would come here. And then you can delete the job now if you want. That you don't want to happen, right? You don't want somebody else to come and delete your job, right? So this activity has to be controlled. So this is controlled by S underscore BTS and touch core GOP. Understand? So suppose there's a job here and it's not there anymore, see? So suppose I go and delete your job. Next day when you come, you want to check the log. It's not there. So you don't know what happened to it. So that's a problem, major, major problem. For example, now it's gone, but if I, let's say this. Let's say if I want to reschedule this job, I can copy this job. So Z something. Okay, it's scheduled, right? And I can release it. See? I can release somebody else's job which is scheduled. Right? Or I can, like I said, delete. Or some, let's say some job is running, I can stop it. Right? All these activities that you see, you know, job, check status, cancel active jobs, reschedule, copy, repeat scheduling, change. All these activities that you see for background jobs is controlled by S underscore BTCH underscore job. That's why this object has to be tightly controlled. Okay? You don't want somebody else to come and delete your jobs. Okay? Now, typically what happens is, depending on the area, the functional area, they also have, they have specific IDs for each area. So let's say for you'll have ID for running the finance related jobs, they'll have, let's say, an ID saying FI batch. To running the materials management related jobs, you will have an ID called, a generic ID called MM batch. To running HR related jobs, they'll have a generic ID called HR batch. Okay? So you can also control, so using another object, you can also control what generic ID authorizations, what generic ID can you use to run the jobs. Okay? And that object is S underscore BTCH underscore NAM. So authorization object S underscore BTCH underscore NAM protects what user IDs can be used to execute the job steps. So let's say I assign you, assign to you SM36 or SM37. I'm going to put that in the role. I'll get S underscore BTC underscore job. I'll give whatever authorizations I want. Okay. Now, one more thing, the background jobs that they create, okay, and like many customer places, they also have a particular naming convention. So let's say any, they'll say all HR related jobs should begin with ZHR something. All FI related jobs should begin with ZFI something. So in the job, S underscore BTCH underscore job, okay, in this object, you'll have two fields. One is for activity, other is the job name. Okay? So you can control what kind of jobs can be executed by that particular generic ID or your own ID or create, okay, naming conventions. You follow? So that job can be controlled, everything with a job, okay, including the naming convention. You can only execute or create jobs that specific, that begin with a specific pattern, and that pattern you can specify in that object. Okay. Now NAM BTC, S underscore BTCH underscore NAM protects what user IDs can be used to execute the job steps. Okay. So in the role, you can, for this object, you can specify a user ID. So that user can only use that user ID, generic ID, to execute the jobs. So in the previous example that we just saw for bad job, okay, the background username field contains the user IDs that can be used when scheduling jobs. Okay, so there's another object. So this is also important. Many places they put star, but you want to really put a tight control, you use this object. Don't give star in it. You give the generic ID names. Okay, so in the previous example, like what we just saw, S underscore BTCH underscore NAM, background username would have to list Smith Joe in order to create the background job and schedule it to run under the ID, user ID Smith Joe. Okay. For users who have access to transaction SM37 to monitor the jobs, you need to ensure security is set up correctly. I showed you how. You can delete somebody's job, you can reschedule somebody's job, you can stop somebody's job, right? So in SM37, you need to set that security properly, and that is controlled by S underscore batch job as well as batch NAM. Okay, so suppose when you try to delete a job that is run by some other user ID for which you don't have access, you cannot delete it. So if batch NAM contains XYZ and the job is run by ABC. Okay, so if you try to delete ABC's job, you cannot do it because you have access to XYZ jobs. Okay, some background jobs have spool requests as part of their output. Okay, like I showed you, right? Click on the print icon. So if I go here, so you select the job and click on the spool. Now this action is also very important because many times what happens is the jobs that run send the output to spool. Spool is for printing. Okay, so if you select the job and click on this spool button here, you can take a look at the output. Our users can see what was the output. So if somebody is printing us confidential information, mm-hmm, and people have access to this feature, the spool action, mm-hmm, then everybody has access to viewing, can see that confidential data, which you don't want. So some of these things, you know, you need to worry about as far as background jobs are concerned. Okay, so as a security administrator, you should ensure that users can view the logs of the jobs that they create, their own jobs, or the jobs that are executed by generic user IDs. Okay, so some background jobs have spool requests as part of their output. This could include invoices that need to be printed and mailed out, checks that need to be mailed, pay stubs, and so on. If someone executes a background job and goes to SM37 to monitor the background job, they should be able to see pull requests of their own jobs only, not from other jobs. Okay. Now this is the mother of all objects as far as background jobs are concerned. This is the batch administration object, s_btch_adm. No matter how you control btch_job, you may be very stingy in that. You know, you can probably, you give only display access in btch_job. You give very specific IDs in btch_nav. But if this object contains, this has got only one field in it, okay, yes or no. What it means is whether you can administer background jobs or not. And administration background jobs involves several tasks such as defining background jobs, maintaining events for use for background processing, monitoring background jobs, performing analysis of background jobs, and debugging and improving performance of background jobs. Anything that you do, anything that you can do using SM37, okay, if this object contains the value y, it's got only one field with two values, yes and no. If this object contains y as access to users, no matter what you do with btch_job and btch_nav, they're all overwritten by this object. So this means if you give y for btch_adm, you're basically giving complete access to background job administration. Okay, so this is amongst the three, I would say this is the most important one, should be tightly controlled. Any role that you see btch_adm is there, ensure that either it is disabled or it contains the value no. N. Okay? It should not be Y. If you really want to control background jobs, the object should be btch_job. That should be the object you should be looking at. And btch_adm should be disabled. So btch_adm declares if the person is the background administrator. Being a background administrator enables you to perform all operations on all jobs. Okay? So disable this wherever you see in a role and control the background jobs using btch_jobs. Okay?